I was going to say, do you want to hear about the time I smuggled a small glass pipe in my vagina at a music festival and then let strangers smoke off of it?
Yes, that is good. Yes, do tell.
I mean, I rinsed it off in a porta potty, but I definitely was vag packing.
Remember when we first met John McClane? Argyle picked him up from the plane and took him down to Nakatomi Tower at the Christmas party. And the terrorists were overzealous, but it was sweet when they killed Ellis. And with a little help from Alan, John McClane.
Welcome back to Shat the Movies podcast, the podcast where we ask, were the movies we loved when we were growing up really that good? Have you caught yourself thinking, why don't they make movies like they used to? Can you still remember spending your Friday night searching for the perfect movie rental at Blockbuster Video? Do you even know what Blockbuster Video is? If you answered yes, then this is the podcast for you. I'm your host, Gene Lyons. Alongside me is my co-host, Big D, Dick Ebert.
Good evening.
And we have a very special repeat guest host, Kerri Gross.
Hello.
This week, we're going to take a look back in time and decide if our favorite films still hold up. Each week, the audience selects from six movie choices that we break out in the race car VHS tape rewinder and watch the movie that tallied the highest number of votes. At the end of the podcast, Big D, Kerri, and I will provide the audience with the number of wipes each movie would take to get off your respective bums. Big D, what do we have this week?
So this was a category that was suggested by one of our listeners. It was 80s and 90s gambling movies. And I don't have the final percentages because we mentioned it a few weeks back and somehow got deleted. But it was Maverick, Hard Eight, which again, I don't know what it was, Rounders, and then the winner, at, I think it was almost 50%, was the 1995 Martin Scorsese classic Casino.
And I initially was really excited about Casino. Out of this bunch, now there are other gambling movies from the 90s and 80s that I really love, but out of this bunch, Casino was the one that I was pulling for, and I was glad to see it win. And then Kerri pointed out that it's 3 hours, and I immediately regretted my decision.
It's a long 3 hours, too.
Yeah, no joke. I don't know about you guys. I had to break this watching down over, you know, 2 days. So last night, you know, I started watching, I think about midnight, and I watched the rise of Ace, and then today I watched The Fall. So it split it up nicely, but it was a long movie.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up, Big D, because as I was watching it, I couldn't help but think, you know, now that we're living in an age where miniseries and limited run series are so prevalent, either on Netflix or Hulu or Amazon or even HBO, I couldn't help but think this would be fantastic as a series, not a movie.
Yeah, I thought the same thing, like a la, you know, Breaking Bad. If they had broken up each little individual story as hour-long episodes, this wouldn't have been so painful.
So if you haven't seen Casino, it's a 1995 American epic crime drama directed by Martin Scorsese, starring Robert DeNiro, Joe Pesci, and Sharon Stone. It's based on the nonfiction book Casino, Love and Honor in Las Vegas by Nicholas Pileggi. The two previously collaborated on the hit film Goodfellas in 1990. And the film marks the eighth collaboration between director Scorsese and De Niro, following Mean Streets, Taxi Driver, New York, New York, Raging Bull, The King of Comedy, Goodfellas, and Cape Fear. In Casino, De Niro stars as Sam Ace Rothstein, a Jewish-American gambling handicapper who's called by the Italian mob to oversee the day-to-day operations at the Tangiers Casino in Las Vegas. And his character is based on Frank Rosenthal, who ran the Stardust, Fremont, and Hacienda casinos in Vegas for the Chicago outfit from the 1970s until the early 1980s. Casino was released November 22nd, 1995, to a mostly positive critical response and was a box office success. Sharon Stone's performance was unanimously praised, earning her a Golden Globe Award for Best Actress in a Motion Picture and a nomination for the Academy Award for Best Actress. So, Big D, we always ask the question, where were you when, and what are your memories of this movie? Where were you when you saw Casino?
I got to tell you, I don't recall. And part of that is due to the fact that you mentioned earlier that Martin Scorsese likes to pair up and partner with, you know, different groups of actors. So in my mind, they've kind of blended into one large movie. There's scenes in Casino that it could have been Goodfellas. There's Goodfellas scenes here. I mean, you have De Niro who did Cape Fear, Taxi Driver. It was difficult to keep them apart, so I don't know. But it had to be sometime around they came out.
Yeah, in the mid-90s, my older cousin Pej, who was also the guy that got me into ninja movies in the 80s, he was kind of like my main influence for film. And so he showed me like this whirlwind of mobster movies. It just seemed like Scorsese was really hot in the 90s. And so there was like Goodfellas, then there was other ones that were kind of related, Untouchables, Bronx Tale, Carlito's Way, The Godfather, like all those kind of came out in a rush in the 90s. and I honestly couldn't tell them apart. It was like Rambo and Rocky. Like as a kid, you just got them all mixed up. So I've never seen a mob movie that I didn't like, but I definitely didn't know the difference. How about you, Kerri?
This was definitely first time for me, and I'll say I was a little struggling with this. I don't really care about mob movies or gambling movies, but I have liked some Scorsese, and I do love Robert De Niro. Taxi Driver is one of my favorite movies, but I'd have to agree with Gene that I couldn't tell, you know, same thing with some scenes could be Goodfellas, Casino. I even confused it with Scarface for a little bit. I don't know. So I don't think I've seen it before. Definitely not in its entirety, not in the whole 3 hours.
Yeah. And I think it's interesting that some of those other movies that we mentioned, particularly Godfather, did run on pretty long, but they didn't feel nearly as long as this. Something about the pacing, even though it was action packed and had a lot going on with really good dialogue, it just really, really dragged. And I think as we go through the review here, that's really going to impact my score, certainly.
I totally agree.
All right, Big D, on that note, roll the trailer.
I was a hell of a handicapper, I can tell you that. I had it down so good that I ran paradise on Earth. I had one of the biggest casinos in Las Vegas to run. The Tangiers. You know, if I did it, I'd have to run on my way.
Nobody's going to interfere with you running the casino, I guarantee it. Nicky,
you're a guy. Make a lot of money for us. So keep a good eye on it.
All right. Look at this place. It's made of money. What do you think about me moving out here?
I just got to tell you, it's no joke out here. You got to keep a low profile. Right off the bat, they don't like guys like us.
Go! Oh, yeah, oh.
You like your money a lot,
yes,
don't you?
Yes, a lot.
Well,
how about that?
I want to settle down. I want a family.
You got the wrong girl.
You'll be set up for the rest of your life.
You don't know me. What, do you know me 2-3 months?
They had it all. They ran the show. And it was paradise while it lasted.
They found a guy's head in the desert. That's no good.
We got a problem.
He doesn't listen to me. Maybe he should get lost for a while. Take a vacation.
Can't make it any clearer, Sam. I would just get out.
I'd try to do everything for you, even though I knew deep down inside you would bury me.
I buried you. You buried yourself.
I have to be able to trust you with my life. Can I trust you? Can I trust you?
I will go to the FBI. I will go to the police. I am not protecting you anymore.
You want me to get out of my own town? You only exist out here because of me.
He's a loose cannon.
No! Stop it!
You realize what you can do? You can get us all killed!
You want to get rid of me? Here I am. Go ahead, get rid of me.
All right, it's 1973, and sports handicapper and mafia associate Sam Ace Rothstein is sent to Las Vegas to run the Teamsters Union-funded Tangiers Casino on behalf of the Chicago outfit, which secretly controls the Teamsters, while Philip Green serves as the mob's frontman. Taking advantage of gaming laws that allow him to work in a casino while his gaming license is pending, Sam doubles the casino's profits, which are skimmed by the mafia before they're reported to income tax agencies. Impressed with his work, mafia boss Remo Gaggi sends Sam's childhood friend and mob enforcer Nicholas Nicky Santoro and his associate Frank Frankie Marino to protect Sam and the whole operation. Nicky's volatile temper soon gets him banned from every casino in Las Vegas, so he gathers his own crew and engages in independent shakedowns and burglaries instead.
So Scorsese is obviously a film legend, and his directing style, you can spot it. And he makes 1970s Vegas look sexy as fuck to me. I was engaged right away. I mean, no one does a single take sequence like Scorsese. I mean, in Goodfellas, you have the famous Copacabana scene where they're walking in through the entrance and they're going through the kitchen. Here, he has some scenes in the beginning where they're doing some great use of exposition. They're walking us through how the casino works into the money room and the counting. It was great. I mean, I'm starting off and I'm loving it. I knew it was going to be 3 hours, but I was thinking maybe it's not going to be that bad because it's beautiful.
I mean, yeah, Scorsese's obviously, you know, attention to detail. You can see from the very beginning, these scenes are beautifully shot. He sticks to this 1970s setting, the costumes, the colors, and maybe that's why it was 3 hours long, is that he had to get all of that in there this whole time, you know?
And it's funny because when you look back on the 70s, you know, typically the way it's depicted, whether it's that 70s show or at costume parties or whatever, it's the gaudiness doesn't make sense. And I always just kind of attribute it to cocaine. I was like, well, that's why everyone dressed the way they did in the 70s. But here you get a sense that there was an aesthetic there, and it was, and you could look smooth, you could look cool. And B, you know, De Niro's got these loud ass suits, and all the colors of Vegas are so garish, but it kind of works. I'm surprised you mentioned how good everything looked, because my opening feeling about this movie is, you know, it's 1995, so we're in the era of Pulp Fiction, we're in the era of, you know, The Matrix, roughly, and so I'm expecting really good effects. And that opening car explosion looked terrible. It was a really rough edit. You could see the movie clipping. You could tell there's a dummy in the car, and you can actually see that frame stop. I just don't understand why a movie that is so meticulously done had these weird moments where things just didn't look right.
I think you can go back to it was 95. And I also noticed that the explosion, when I say it looked beautiful, I'm talking the setup of the scenes in the casino. This movie was made before you had Blu-ray and 4K TVs and now 8K TVs. So once you saw it in a movie, I think you were so shocked by the surprise that you just didn't notice. Yeah, there's a full second where you see De Niro get in the car, he's smoking, and then dummy. So yeah, I think before Blu-ray, it was probably okay.
Yeah, and Big D, you mentioned that sequence of you know, the introductions and the exposition and stuff. And there's that scene, I love it, where they're showing who's watching who in the casino. The dealers are watching the players, the boxmen are watching the dealers, the pit bosses are watching the boxmen, and on and on. And what I love about this is I'm salivating, because Scorsese, whenever he's doing this like setup of the system, you know, with regards to the mafia, he makes it look so civilized and glamorous and intelligent. And you know, like, he's setting it up for the horrors that are to come, right? Like, shit's going to get nasty in a hurry. And that was one of my favorite things about this movie, is watching everything build up and then just watching it all come tumbling down.
I think I was so shocked by the opening scene that he gets blown up right away. I mean, I didn't pay attention. I didn't see that there was a dummy, but I definitely felt like shit's going to go down in this movie. I already know he's going to die. The car's blowing up. But yeah, I didn't notice a dummy.
And another thing, you know, if I'm going to gripe about anything in this movie, I felt like the double narration really bothered me. You don't normally see that, right? So typically in a movie, whether it's A Bronx Tale or Carlito's Way, you have a single narrator that's running you back through, or even something as shitty as A Christmas Story. They had the sense to have one narrator. And in this, you had the double narration from both Nicky and Sam. And then they had two expressly written time jumps in the first 2 minutes. It was like 1985, then it's like, a, you know, 10 years before that. I feel like that made it feel very 1995. It just felt a little clunky in that sense. But I did love when Joe Pesci says, back home years ago, and then the screen literally says, back home years ago.
Yeah, I thought the exposition was just going to be in the first 10 minutes. And then it just kept going and going. And yeah, I like that, the back home. But they also do where they're sometimes having a conversation in code, and then the exposition is translating what they're saying. So you needed it. Imagine how long this movie would be if you couldn't just do an audio exposition. If you had to explain everything, this would be like an 8-hour miniseries.
As soon as Joe Pesci's narration starts, I wanted to blow my fucking brains out. He literally sounds like his nose is plugged. Does he need septoplasty or something? I don't know. I can only see him as Harry from Home Alone.
I'm glad you mentioned Home Alone, because in Home Alone, he doesn't have a ton. Joe Pesci doesn't have a ton of lines. And in this movie, you take him out of the picture and you can just hear him and you're really focused on that voice. And then he's talking way more than he usually does in a movie. It was off-putting. But by the end of it, I really cared for Nicky as a character.
But why is Joe Pesci such an iconic tough guy? I get it. The scene where he's defending De Niro in the bar and he attacks the guy with the ballpoint pen, we get that he's psychotic, but why is he such a tough guy? If you look at him, he's not physically imposing. I don't necessarily buy that he's this intimidating character.
What kind of surprised me, though, is there's a scene in the movie where they strip him down to his undies, and he's a pretty stout fellow. Like, he's not stringy by any means. And I was like, okay, I could see that. He's just compact. He's like a running back, you know. But beyond that, nobody delivers those lines like Pesci can. Like in that opening scene you mentioned, where he stabs the guy with the pen, and he's like, "Do you hear a little girl? Like, what happened to the tough guy? He told my friend to take the pen and shove it up his ass." And he's, you know, oddly likable when he's doing it. But what I'm wondering is, you know, part of protecting a guy isn't just physically protecting him. It's you protect the reputation. You stay under the radar. And he's so flashy with this that I can't believe that the mob would actually entrust him to, you know, to help Sam out.
I'm just surprised they would give him any important job. You need crazy people like him, but you wouldn't necessarily let him off on his own, take him off the leash. You'd keep him pretty tightly under control and then just point him in a direction. And I just felt like it was a rehash of Goodfellas. I couldn't distinguish after a few minutes what scene I had seen in each movie. There's a famous scene here, again, that you referenced, where they're dragging him in his underwear into the hole. I could have sworn that was Goodfellas. I bet if I did a supercut and started mixing scenes of, you know, oh, do I make you laugh? Am I a clown? If I put that into Casino, half the people who watch it wouldn't even pick up it's a different movie.
I just love that both of you referred to Goodfellas as Goodfellas. Like, so Carrie's got an excuse because she's never lived in New York. But Big D, you should be ashamed of yourself right now. Like, I hear my accent coming out just by, I'm so upset by it. But again, I think the writing in this movie was one of the strengths, though, in the fact that all the dialogue was brilliant. Even if the movie dragged and the story kind of meandered, the dialogue was sharp.
Well, I did read that a lot of the dialogue between De Niro and Pesci was improvised. There was like an interview with Scorsese, and he said he told him where to start and where to finish, but everything in between just kind of figured out. And I think that's pretty, I mean, I'm pretty impressed by that.
Just so you know, just for the record, Joe Pesci's 5'4".
I'm 5'5".
Yeah, right. So you're not stout. So whoever that body double was in the tighty whities who got drug into that hole, that was not Joe Pesci.
Yeah, one of the openings is when he first meets Ginger, and Sharon Stone is like, you know, looking at Joe Pesci. Joe Pesci's looking up at her. She's so much bigger than he is that it was just mind boggling. But you know, we see Nicky pulling off a bunch of a violent acts, but he's not the only one. And we get some really great scenes here of torture and heinous deaths. And did you guys have any favorites?
The money and hammer scene, that was, I mean, De Niro is such a badass. Like, he smashes that guy's fingers after trying to determine which hand would be more useful to him to have, you know, damaged, and then drags the other guy in and gives him an option. Like, do you want to take the money or do you want to cut your fingers off? And he just, without a doubt, I'm gone. It's cool. We're good. I'll leave. No big deal.
Yeah. The exact line is, you can either have the money and the hammer or walk out of here, but you can't have both.
Yeah, Money in the Hammer was great, but how about when Nicky's got Tony Dog's head in a vice and he's just squeezing it until his eyeball pops out? Like, that surprised me even. I thought it was just going to be like the torture rack in The Princess Bride, but it was much, much worse. So Sam meets and falls in love with a hustler and formal prostitute, Ginger McKenna. They conceive a daughter and marry, but their marriage is proven difficult by Ginger's covetousness and her love for her manipulative former boyfriend, con artist turned pimp Lester Diamond, who is ordered beaten severely by Sam and Nicky after they catch him conning Ginger out of some money. Ginger subsequently turns to alcohol.
So I texted both of you while I was watching this, and I posed the question. I said, who plays a better damaged chick, Sharon Stone in Casino or Robin Wright in Forrest Gump?
And I went with Robin Wright, but I read it differently. I guess when I was interpreting it, when you said damaged chick, I was like, the better damaged chick, meaning like the less horrible one. Like, which one would you have to deal with? And I get now, who's better at playing one?
Yeah, what I meant was who was more believable? Because you had Robin Wright in Forrest Gump, where she's in the party scenes and she's up on the ledge. And you see her slowly devolve and kind of go her life out of control. We also see that with Sharon Stone here. And Sharon was nominated for an Academy Award that she didn't win. But you both were raving about her performance. I think Robin Wright is a more realistic, out-of-control party girl.
I think they're different. I mean, with Robin Wright, you see this sweet side of her, this genuine caring, you know, she, you know, cares about Forrest. But Sharon Stone is a fucking prostitute, money hungry, making a deal with this person that she doesn't love for money, and then turns to drugs and alcohol. Like, there's not really anything good about her other than that she's drop dead gorgeous in this movie.
Yeah, and I think Robin Wright is fairly forgettable. I mean, like, until you actually brought her up, I didn't even remember that she was Jenny in Forrest Gump. Sharon Stone's first second on the screen when she's like, I told you I was hot tonight. She was a beauty that the 1990s weren't even ready for. Like, in her prime, she made my jaw drop when she came on screen. I was like, holy shit. And those looks, again, those, like, this was the 70s and it's easy to look like shit. But the different looks that she had were all phenomenal. Every gown, every like casual outfit, every hairdo was on point.
Yeah. I mean, as a woman, I saw those dresses, all those outfits, the jewelry, the makeup, the hair, and I'm really impressed. I mean, I think I read something that she had like 70 costume changes or something in this whole film. And they're just, everything was fucking beautiful. And the scenes in her closet, like I would just die to be on set and go through everything that they pulled for her to wear. And I even mentioned earlier that white dress that she's wearing in the scene where she throws the poker chips up. I was reading something that dress with all the sequins and the beading weighed like 46 pounds. It's insane.
And there's remarkable attention to detail throughout this movie. Scorsese was very insistent upon the way he wanted to shoot things. And he actually wanted the casino to look real. So he was not satisfied with the set. They wanted him to shoot it on a set, on a built set. And he made an arrangement with the Riviera in Vegas for 6 weeks, four nights a week. They shot from midnight to 10 a.m. When the casino was less busy. So they just took a corner of the Riviera, and all the background stuff where people are gambling, that's real gameplay that people are gaming. And for extra authenticity, they actually used real dealers and real pit bosses whenever possible. So the people that you see, they didn't have to train them to be pit bosses. They just were.
So speaking of Sharon Stone, did you guys see who else that like tried out for the role? There's like Nicole Kidman, Melanie Griffith, Cameron Diaz.
Oh, God.
Uma Thurman, Michelle Pfeiffer. I guess Tracy Lords was like going to be it. And then Sharon Stone pulled some strings. She wasn't able to show up for her audition. And Martin Scorsese like went and found her and made her audition on the spot and she got it. But oh, and Madonna. Can you fucking imagine Madonna?
Wait. Can I rewind? Did you say Tracy Lords?
Yeah. Crybaby?
Yeah. Our younger viewers, and you might not know who she really is. Do you know her history, Tracy Lords?
Porn?
That she was underage when she started doing pornography? That she was 17 when she did her first films? And there was a
big... So very similar to Ginger, right?
Yeah, I think that... I don't know that she could have carried the acting chops, but the background would have been there for her to be a method actor.
That leads to Big D's other podcast, This Week in Underage Vintage Porn. Catch that also on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts.
Give us a 5-star review. But yeah, Sharon Stone, she's great. And I got to tell you, I can't. They try to play Ace as a victim. After watching this and paying attention, he deserves everything he gets. Now, the daughter, she doesn't deserve to have Ginger as a mom, but she tells him right away. She says, I'm not marriage material. I don't love you. I'm not the type of girl. She gives him every chance. But yet Ace still thinks he's going to domesticate Ginger. That's not going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely portrayed as like a business transaction. Like he is this, you know, known in the casino community, mob community, very, you know, wealthy guy. And he just wants the most beautiful woman in that scene on his arm. And it seemed like a business transaction, but she was upfront right away. Like, she says, I'm not in love with you.
I mean, for God's sake, if you have to ask somebody, can I trust you? Can I trust you? If you have to ask them 4 times in a row and they don't answer before you marry them, don't get married.
Now, there's a part of her that attracts him specifically, and I can relate to this, is he is impressed with the way that she operates. And so he's in love with casinos, right? He's in love with gaming, and he sees this woman who can play the whole system, right? From the valets to the dealers to the gamers. Like she's sitting there and she's got the whole thing spinning, and he thinks that that expertise extends to every avenue of her life. And I had a very similar situation when I tried to date a bartender, and behind the bar, she was magic. Like she had everybody wrapped around her finger, and she was, you know, quick, never missed a beat, very clever. But you got her out of there and she's a raging alcoholic and her whole life is in shambles. She only has one environment in which she can function. And I think that's what got him. But you're absolutely right. He's not listening to her at any point.
No. And to be honest, he's expecting her to change. And that's what's wrong. If he's in love with the character and the person who you say that's what he's attracted to, they get married. He takes her home. He says, the party life's over. You're not going to drink. You're now different. You're going to live this life. He expects her to become something she's not. It's not like she's that bartender outside and she's a train wreck. He completely tries to lock it down. So I don't blame her for calling Lester.
I feel like that quote when he's talking about love, that you absolutely 100% have to trust your partner, you know, whatever. I can just picture it in like some rainbow setting, contrived platitude meme, and then just underneath it, just be like Robert De Niro. I need to have that hanging in my apartment.
And speaking of Lester, James Woods plays Lester. I think he's really good at what he does. And it's an interesting role for Woods because that's not really his normal thing that he does. But there's the wedding scene. And you could see that she's, you know, Ginger's unhappy the whole time. Like Sharon Stone's doing a great job of being the, you know, the bride with a plastic smile. But you can tell she's dying on the inside. And then you finally see her crying. But there's this wonderful transition where the wedding music cuts out and you've got just the voiceover from Lester. And first thing you think it's Ace asking, you know, can you feel me in your heart? Can you feel me in the pit of your stomach? Can you feel me in you? And then you realize like your brain's like, that's not Robert De Niro. And so you're searching. And then they do the reveal. It's Ginger cry talking. And then you see Lester and he's just fucking trashy.
Apparently that whole scene was improvised. Originally, Scorsese just wanted her in the lobby crying on the phone, implying that there was someone else on the line. But apparently Woods came up with this idea that he wanted to be in this room and have a prostitute, you know, doing lines of coke while he's telling her how much he loves her on the phone. And that was all improvised. And I thought it was a great scene.
Oh, no, it was one of the most powerful scenes in the movie. And I just really love the way they introduced it, too. They could have, you know, made it really obvious. And a lot of times when they use tricks, especially in the 90s, the tricks that they're attempting just don't pan out.
So what do we think now? We're starting to see also some of the backstory of Nicky. Nicky, I think we've all had those friends who we enjoy in small doses. But you know, when you bring them too close into your orbit, that they start to just fuck shit up. Nicky, without him going out to Vegas, none of this ever happens.
No, absolutely. And he doesn't see it, you know, and it's funny because, you know, he asks permission to be out there. And again, you're looking at Sam and you're like, just say no. And Sam's an honest guy. But again, these guys go way back. And yeah, Nicky is, I mean, we've all got those friends. And I love that you see it kind of creeping in gradually where, you know, it's bad news, but you don't know how bad it could get. Like, I didn't imagine it was going to get as bad as it did.
No.
But at this point, you know, again, we're talking through this plot pretty quickly, but this is all dragged out over a very, very long period of time. They, you know, Scorsese takes time really letting this unfold, and you're back and forth, you know, you're back east and then you're in Vegas and there's conversations here and conversations there and spanning shots at the casino. And I feel for me, this is when when I checked the time to see how much was left and it was still like 2.5 hours. I was like, Jesus Christ.
No, and at this point, I was just so bored with the plot. You know, I'm mesmerized with the costumes and the setting and stuff. But I mean, I even had to look at the script notes here to understand, like, what the fuck was going on and who's who. And at this point, we're not even halfway through and I'm lost.
And there's these side stories, like, you know, they're talking about when Nicky, you know, flies into when he flies home and, you know, the cops are all over him because they're just looking for any reason to, you know, bust him. And you got a cute moment with like his wife's, you know, smuggling diamonds in her hair. But it's, you know, and then he gives her like a slap. And I get it. Like there's a reason for everything that they're doing. But it's just like just because there's a reason doesn't mean you need to include it.
So speaking of smuggling diamonds or smuggling anything on your person, I was going to ask you guys, have you ever smuggled anything on a plane or in a venue or?
So last year, Das Bunker in LA, they had their 20th anniversary. And what? So it's an industrial club, Big D. And so
Das Bunker,
yeah. And so I was there for the 20th anniversary and I took like a bunch of mushrooms. And so I was like, I knew that I was going to be in there. It's the sort of thing where you get in there, it's like, you know, the sun's still up and you're there until, you know, 3 a.m. or something like that. So I knew that I needed to make this shit last. And so what I would do is I was taking Ziploc baggies of mushrooms and just put them right in my gooch. And I would just hide them in my gooch, get through the door.
What?
And then I'd be dancing.
I'm sorry, as a nurse.
What is a gooch?
What's a gooch?
Your perineum.
Your cheeks?
Okay. I was going to say, I didn't learn that in nursing school. Again, a gooch. I'm sorry.
What? Your taint. Your cheeks?
Your taint.
How are you getting them to stick there?
So what you do is you
lick it.
You got to lick it before you stick it, Big D. No, I mean, I'm wearing underwear. So it's up in the gooch.
But again, imagine you're a Ken doll. It's the area between up in it. You're making it sound like
the vinyl pants hold it in place.
Ah, Okay.
Yeah. So basically what I would do is I would start off the day drunk. So I'd drink a bunch. And I got my buzz from the drinking, go into the club drunk, dance for like 4 or 5 hours until the buzz wore off. And then I got round two right in my gooch or perineum or taint. So I would go in the bathroom, take that out, eat those. So imagine I'm eating mushrooms that have been in my underwear between my scrotum and my anus for like 4 or 5 hours. And that was 3 days straight.
Did you share?
Yeah, that was my question.
No.
No. We know the same people, so I'm going to start asking if anyone's ever done mushrooms with you.
Well, the smell of the mushrooms might have hidden like the smell of the bag. You couldn't really tell what was sinking.
So the next sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, do you want to hear about the time I smuggled a small glass pipe in my vagina at a music festival and then let strangers smoke off of it?
Yes, that is good. Well, yes, do tell.
I mean, I rinsed it off in a porta potty, but I definitely was vag packing for that music festival.
Is that an actual term, vag packing?
I've heard other people use it. I don't know if it's like a technical term, but there's some space in there to hold some things, you know?
Yeah, I think I was at Riot Fest a few years ago and somebody referred to it as like, just keep it in my personal pocket. I was like, your what? Like, my personal pocket. I was like, So.
Got it.
I mean, hey, it's what it's there for.
But as a nurse, I would have been afraid of that thing breaking. I know it's probably Pyrex, but shit happens. You don't want to lose it up there.
I wasn't a nurse at the time, no. I've since evolved. What I do now is when we go down to Mexico and we have shrooms, one of my friends will grind them all up and you can buy empty capsules online. We'll put the shroom powder in the capsules and then you just put it in a women's health vitamin bottle and throw it in your bag. And they're not going to break apart those pills and test them.
You might be the only person who's ever smuggled drugs into Mexico. I've never heard of that.
Yeah, but that's all fun and games until your mother finds them like in your apartment while she's staying over and is like, oh, I need some vitamins. That shit could go wrong quick.
No, that's when the fun and games begin. So Sam makes an enemy in County Commissioner Pat Webb for firing his brother-in-law, Don Ward, for incompetence. When Sam refuses to reinstate him, Webb pulls Sam's license from the backlog, forcing him to face a hearing for his gaming license while secretly arranging for the board to deny Sam. Sam blames that incident on Nikki's recklessness, and the two argue furiously in the desert after Sam attempts to tell Nikki to leave Las Vegas.
Okay, so you guys were saying that you were kind of losing your momentum earlier on. I wrote it down. At this point, it's an hour and 25 minutes into the movie. That's what I consider the first act, the rise of Ace. Everything that to that point to me was riveting. You know, it was compelling storytelling. You were learning how Vegas works. You were learning about the characters. At this point in the movie, once he makes that decision to fire, you know, that hick who he puts in charge of the slot machines, it goes downhill. I wish I could say fast, but it just starts to gradually go down and they started to lose me here.
Yeah, I have some amnesia from this time here. You know, like there's the scene where the younger guy goes to court with the old redheaded lady and there's a shooting that I'll get to the technicality of the shooting. But I'm like, what in the fuck is going on? Who are these people? Are they partners? I mean, I just had he not shot that bitch in the head, none of that would have been entertaining.
All right, so Don Ward is the guy in charge of the slots, and he's that big hee-haw with the bolo tie, you know, the real tall guy, and he's so likable, like he's so sweet, and I get it that he's an idiot, but I don't understand. This is where it's his hubris and his idiocy there. Why can't he just make him a greeter or put him on the bar staff or like some sort of a hospitality guy? I get that he can't trust him. I get that he doesn't trust him. He's like, look, he's either scamming us. Or he's a complete idiot. I can't trust him. He costs us millions of dollars. But I wanted Don Ward. I would go to a casino just because Don Ward was working there. He was great.
No, and I think you're right. His hubris is starting to take over, where he's been warned, you know, keep it low level. Don't make a stink. He knows he doesn't even have a gaming license. And the guy gives him every chance again. Hey, are you sure you can't give him a job in the back? You sure? And then he openly threatens him and says, you know, you guys kind of need us. You know, this isn't your home. For a guy like Ace, who is very detailed oriented, it doesn't seem within his character to kind of just be so reckless.
That being said, the scene between De Niro and Pat Webb, the county commissioner, the details are just masterful. So first you start off, you see him doing De Niro's doing like a shot of like stomach medicine, right? He's like doing some Pepto or something like that, or Imodium or something. And then he gets up and he's got no pants on. He goes and puts on his trousers, you know, leg by leg. He's already got the shoes on, though. There's so much you're learning from those details. And then they do this great shot where they go down to Pat Webb's boots and De Niro's dress shoes. They're standing next to each other. And it's just that contrast between the two men, that the East meets West, and this culture clash. And then you have this precise conversation of two powerful men that both derive their strength from two different sources, right? So you've got the guy that's the local, that this is the Vegas original. And then you've got the mafia moving into Vegas. And this movie's all about those parallels. Where do people get their power? What are people's fears? What are people's strengths? You know, where do people lose control and where do they regain it? And I thought that it was just really well acted. And I just love that scene.
The movie is 3 hours long. And I think in here, there's a good 2 hour movie, 2 hour and 25 minute movie, which is Goodfellas. You know, that's 225. If you trim down, you know, you were saying there, Kerri, that you didn't understand who the partner was. We didn't need to go into the background of the Kevin Pollak character, Philip Green. Just tell us he's a silent partner. The whole shooting the woman in the head, it starts to go after, you know, Ace then hires Jonathan and David in their Tigers. He's got a silver Rolls Royce. He gets a TV show. He's bitching and moaning about how many blueberries are in the muffins. There's a lot of time spent here that we could have pared it down.
Yeah, I did. You know, again, the Green like side story wasn't really all that important, but I did love seeing Nicky at work. That confidence he had when he popped the 22 on the old lady's head, and he cups his arm around her head, and he's so confident there's going to be no exit wound because it's a 22 that he shoots with a window to his left, and he knows the bullets aren't coming out of her skull. I thought that was great.
No, he would have definitely shot himself in the forearm like 7 times. And I love how he just like pats her head very nicely afterwards, like he's singing her to sleep. All right, good night.
Good night, Grandma. And he tilts her head and the blood just pours out of her mouth onto her nightie.
You can see her swallow twice there as well. After she's dead, she swallows.
And I think that this is the crux of the argument that we're going to have, or the debate we're going to have over this movie, is that we simultaneously just said that storyline wasn't necessary, but we really love that scene. And I think that's the story of this movie.
And I think that's what Scorsese does, is he gets all this great material, these great shots, and he has a hard time. Yeah, that's a great shot, but is it worth the 8-10 minutes in the end? I don't know that it is. And a lot of times, the more you add, yes, it adds some flavor and some realism to it, but you start losing the focus on that core and you just start to wander.
Did somebody mention more characters? Because the casino counters start stealing money for themselves, prompting the Midwest Mafia bosses to put Artie Piscano of the Kansas City Mafia in charge of overseeing the transactions. Piscano is unable to find the thieves, but he keeps tabs of everything he knows about Las Vegas in a private notebook, ranting about it in his grocery store. The FBI, investigating a separate crime, have wired Piscano's store, and Piscano's detailed complaints, complete with names, spurs the FBI to begin investigating the casino. Meanwhile, Sam finally seeks a divorce from Ginger, tired of her alcoholism. Ginger kidnaps their daughter, Amy, taking her to Los Angeles, and plans to flee to Europe with Lester.
Jesus Christ, this is a big bucket, but there's a lot of things going on here. And I do love the fact, how many times do you see it that a crime or something is undone by the simplest fact? You would believe that there is some knucklehead who would be so upset that he has to pay out of pocket for these trips for the mob that he would keep a detailed diary.
And what I love about it is Artie Piscano, like, they don't play him off as a super dope, right? They could have, that's the easy way to do it. Like, oh, like, you know what? I don't know what I'm doing. They don't do that. What they do is they do this grocery store scene and it tells you everything you need to know about him. It's so organic. So he's like, he's bumping things off the shelf with his big ass and he's like apologizing to his mom for cursing, but it's all like, it's shit that I would do, you know? So it's, I'm fascinated by these ideas, and especially living in the Midwest and the East Coast, where like these made men just live in like parts of Long Island or in Kansas City or Chicago. And I think that's the kind of where, you know, shows like The Sopranos were so great, was when you just see their normal like day-to-day shit that they have to do, like go to the grocery store or like go for a jog.
I think that's exactly, you know, what we've been saying since the beginning of this recording, that this could have played out like The Sopranos as an HBO series, one episode at a time with character development, focusing on those little plots building there and not, you know, condensed, not really condensed, all in one film.
So in the end there, you start talking about Lester and we start to see more of his influence on Ginger here. Now, I don't know if it's because I'm a parent now, but the scenes where Lester's on the phone with Ace, Ginger's got the mirror sitting in her lap and she's blowing lines of coke with her daughter right next to her. And she's telling her, honey, honey, you shouldn't do this. You shouldn't do this. And Lester's interaction there, it really, as a father, it upset me. And I had a visceral reaction to it. So that's when you know it's working. When this fictional character of Lester and Ginger make me want to climb through the screen and kill them both.
Yeah, I normally don't care about kids or feel any sympathy for them whatsoever. But that fight between Ginger and Lester in front of Amy, Sam's daughter, it really, really upset me. I grew up in a single parent household, and so I never saw parents fight. My mom's, you know, never dated. She's never remarried or anything like that. So I've never been exposed to this, and they nailed it. I mean, I wanted to cry for that kid. Like, I was feeling a little choked up. Like, what the fuck? There's a child right there. Like, what are you doing?
I also love that the kid just gives it back to Lester. Like, she's so Sam's daughter that she's like, no, you shut up, and then sticks her tongue out at him. But I think this starts to show the decline of Ginger. You know, we start to see her drunk and she's doing the drugs in front of the kid, and you just see what a terrible mom she is and just very selfish and lying. And yeah, this is when you really start to hate Ginger.
Yeah, when they're that scene you're referencing where they're having the fight and she's kind of giving it back to him. Lester in the background says, I'm sending this kid to Bolivia in a fucking box. I'm like, whoa, he's saying this to the child. Now, granted, yeah, she's giving it back, but Ginger, she's leaving her daughter. She's getting high. It's just, I mean, we recently had that case where they found those 13 kids tied up. It's sad to think that there are parents out there who are chasing the high and forgetting about their kids. So Ginger, yeah, she goes downhill real quick here, and I would have liked to give her an extra push.
So Sam convinces Ginger to come back with Amy and then scolds her for stealing his money and kidnapping their daughter. After he overhears Ginger talking on the phone about killing him, he kicks her out of the house but soon relents. Ginger then approaches Nikki for help in getting her valuables from their shared vault in the bank, and the two start an affair. Sam discovers the affair, finding Amy tied to her bed by Ginger, who is with Nikki at his restaurant. Sam disowns Ginger, and so does Nikki. A furious and drunk Ginger crashes her car into Sam's driveway, making a scene, and retrieves the key to the deposit box after distracting the attending police. Even though she succeeds in taking her share of the money from the bank, she's arrested by the FBI as a material witness.
I don't know how this movie doesn't end right here with Sam just fucking killing Ginger. Like, he comes home, he finds his daughter tied to the bed. She's out at the restaurant, high out of her mind, fucking his friend. But meanwhile, she tied their fucking daughter up and left her there. Like, he has friends in the mob. Why didn't they offer just there, right then?
And this is the thing is, I'm glad you said that, Kerri, because it gives me leeway to say this. Like, I was sitting there going, how does Sam, like, Sam is a saint. How does he not slap the ever-loving shit out of Ginger? If someone kidnapped my child, talked about killing me, demanded money, hit me, screamed in my face, I'm not going to kill her, but I'm going to clean her goddamn clock.
Yeah, forget about banging my friend. I don't give a shit about that. You can just kick her out the door. But the child endangerment, I'm sorry, as a father, I know, you know, Sam is, he's got the mob. He's had people killed. I'm killing Ginger with my bare hands. I'm choking the life out of her. There's a scene when she first comes back where he coaxes her and they're sitting, you know, in some public restaurant. And he says, look into my eye. He said, is there anything that you see that makes you think I would ever, under any condition, let you take my child away from me? Ginger should realize at this point, I'm done fucking around. I'm getting out or I'm dead.
Well, and that was actually during the divorce meeting with a lawyer. And what's amazing about that is they're concerned about two different things.
No.
Yeah.
It's when he gets her on the jet, she flies back, they're sitting alone where she finally walks away.
Yeah, he gets like a babysitter so they can go out and have dinner and talk about it.
Yep.
But the other scene where they're fighting, when he goes to get her from like Nikki's restaurant and they're sitting at that table and Nikki's like, play it cool, you know, like don't blow up in here. And she's just like whacked out of her mind. And he's like, fuck you, you fucking cunt, you fucking pig. Like, I just love Robert De Niro in that scene. Like, I absolutely want to strangle her myself and call her a fucking cunt. And that they just nail that scene, that fight scene. A lot of their fight scenes. I mean, later in the movie when they're in the closet and he's like ripping her up by her arm and is like, get the fuck out of the house. Like, all of it just felt very genuine, like a real, if you've ever had those awful relationships when you just want to kill each other and there's nothing left but that fighting, they nailed it.
And watching Ginger completely melt down and get thrown on her ass by both Sam and Nikki, it's no, in no way gratifying. I don't want to see that happen to anybody. But I clapped when Nikki threw her out and she's like, I'm going to go to the FBI. And he's like, OK, be careful. And just waves to her, like completely dismissing her, like she meant shit to him. And so I looked it up because I was like, this is the greatest like bye-bye since Bye Felicia. Same year, 1995 was just a great year for dismissing irate women. But that's going to be my new one now. It's just, okay, be careful.
I also love that tan leather tracksuit she's wearing when he kicks her to the curb.
Was it tan or was it gold?
It was gold.
Yeah, that shit looked bad. But you talked about a lot of the dialogue was improvised. Where Ginger's inside the house and she's rummaging for the keys and she's going through the closet. And the cop is outside sitting with De Niro. To me, gold. De Niro is in his bathrobe. The cop is there and he's like, hey, you know, how you doing, Rick? How's the family? How's it going? Oh, it's great. You know, my wife. That conversation was so genuine and felt so real. You know, juxtaposed to the chaos inside the house. I loved it.
Dude, the exact line, the cop goes, the first thing he says, he's they're just standing outside and the cop looks at Sammy, goes, how's everything besides this? It's amazing. I spit up my coffee and like De Niro, this is De Niro's prime. This is why he's so good. Cause he's like, and he's just playing along like, yeah, you know, like, oh, that's great, man. You had a kid. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I love too. The character of Ace is just like, as crazy as the shit going on, like he's so centered and calm and he knows like, no matter what's going on in there, like I also have a man in my child's bedroom holding a fucking gun. Like, you know, I'll let the cops escort her out, but this ain't fucking over. I'm going to play my cool now. But
is there a better wingman than Billy Sherbert? He makes a quick call. Don Rickles is over there with a shotgun in 2 minutes and he's staying watch all night. You need that man in your corner.
Yeah. I mean, speaking of good wingman, though, like, you know, people feel like Nikki betrayed Sam in this movie. I've heard that a lot from people. But look, I never, ever fuck around with a friend's wife like that. You just don't do that. But I feel like Nikki went above and beyond to try to be a good friend. Like, he resisted many times when I thought he was going to crack. And I imagine most of my friends are not that loyal. Like, given the chance, you know, guy, like men are weak. And I was really surprised that when I recollected this movie, I thought he just right off the bat went for it.
Oh, those scenes with Ginger and Nikki were just so cringeworthy. Like, you just can see how she really is as a person. Like, she's a fucking prostitute. She's hanging off of his arm saying, I need a new sponsor. And it's just like, oh my, I have no respect for her.
Yeah, when she says, I need a new sponsor, he almost immediately takes her by the back of the head and just pushes her down. There's no romance. His old sweaty man balls in that trailer. That shit must have been gross.
Very gross. And I thought, like, she is a fucking prostitute. Like, this is all she is.
Yeah. And if you watch the first time that Nikki is alone with Ginger early on, when Nikki's telling him, hey, go back, it'll work. And he's really trying to help. You can see that she's planting the seeds, that Ginger is trying to use Nikki as a wedge with the hope that maybe he would, you know, turn on Ace and would end up killing him. So yeah, she's been plotting this all the way through, and now it's just come to that dirty, nasty, you know, trailer and then hotel sex.
But I mean, I think all that speaks to the fact that, you know, again, we're talking about how much we hate Ginger at this point and how horrible she is. But again, horrible character, wonderful acting job by Sharon Stone. Like, she goes from in the beginning of the movie where you want her in your life and you're like, look at this amazing woman and she's enchanting and all that stuff. And by the end, you want her dead.
Yeah, that scene when she pulls up in that fucking Mercedes and just starts smashing into the car. Like, first of all, that should be a Mercedes commercial. That thing was a fucking tank. Oh, yeah. The other car totaled. Not a scratch on that Mercedes. She drove that thing to the bank. But I'll say, as a woman once scorned, like, she nailed just that performance alone should have gotten her an Oscar. The screaming, the she's like kicking rocks and screaming at the neighbors, like, what the fuck are you looking at? And just, you know, raging through the whole house. That, as much as I hated her character, the background of it, I just wanted to buy her a fucking drink after that. Like, you are an angry bitch and you nailed it.
Not even that scene. When she finally gets to the bank and she's emptied the deposit boxes and she leaves and you see the feds pull her over, that I was only trying to get my stuff. And I was, it's hard to play a believable person having a meltdown. It's so easy to have that come across as comical. So I'm starting to agree with you here. She didn't win the Oscar that year, but she did win the Golden Globe. So she deserved it.
Fat lot of good that did her. All right, so the FBI moves in and closes the casino. Green decides to cooperate with the authorities. Piscano dies of a heart attack upon observing federal agents discover his notebook. Nicky flees Vegas before he can be caught. The FBI approaches Sam for help, but he turns him down. The aging bosses are arrested and put on trial, but they agree to eliminate anyone involved in the scheme to prevent them from testifying and prolonging their coming sentences. Among them, three casino executives, Teamsters pension fund head Andy Stone, and money courier John Nance. Ginger travels to Los Angeles and ultimately dies of a drug overdose in a motel. Sam is almost killed by a car bomb and suspects Nicky was behind it. But before Sam could take revenge, Nicky and his brother Dominic are savagely beaten by their own crew and buried alive in a cornfield, the bosses having enough of Nicky's behavior.
I to touch back about the loyalty of Nicky, you know, we were saying, you know, condemning him for sleeping with his, you know, best friend's lover and wife or whatever. But he, when she's freaking out and saying, you know, like, if he's that big of a risk, then why don't you kill him? He's like, I'm not going to kill my fucking friend of 35 years, you know? And she's like, what about my money? And he's like, I don't give a fuck about your money. I mean, for a moment, I'm like, well, maybe he is loyal. And then we see later in as the plot develops that, you know, they beat him to death with his baseball bats. He wasn't so loyal after all.
But they never really resolve. They never really resolve whether it was Nicky who tried to put the hit on Sam with the explosion. Sam suspects that it was Nicky, but you never really know.
No, I think it's implied because it was amateurish. If the mob puts a hit on you and they're going to put a bomb, they're going to do it right. You know, it's not going to be an amateur putting a stick of dynamite and it doesn't go off correctly under the passenger seat. That's not how the mob rolls.
Well, and they were so concerned about, you know, whether or not he was breaking that code of when they were like, is he sleeping with the Jew's wife? Like, he was already on their radar. They wanted him out.
Yeah, and I kept, as the movie was going on, I needed to find a reason that would make sense. Why would it be believable they would allow Sam, who is the biggest of all the loose strings out there that could sink you, why would you let him survive? And you'd let him survive because he makes you money. For me, I still don't know if the mob bosses would let him live, you know, with the idea that you don't know that Sam thinks it was somebody other than the mob trying to kill him. You have somebody who would work for the mob, maybe now thinks he survived a mob assassination attempt. He could easily flip. So I still think the mob would have whacked Sam just to be safe.
Yeah, 100%. When he said, oh, they had something else in store for me or whatever, I thought, okay, like, he's going to have some far more grisly death. Like, they're going to make sure it gets done right. I thought he's going to get, you know, when he's at his house in San Diego, he ends up getting killed there. But out of all the deaths, suffocation, getting shot, you know, all that, definitely Nicky had the worst one. Like, you know, and Pesci actually, in shooting this, when they were hitting him with the bats, he actually got a broken rib. And what's weird about it is 15 years before, his same rib was broken during the filming of Raging Bull. So Pesci, you know, bad luck with the ribs. And the other one that I wanted to point out was Ginger's death. You know, the first time I watched this movie and the first few times I watched this movie, I thought that that she had just OD'd. But if you listen, Sam says that she died of a hot dose. And I didn't know what that was, so I had to look it up. And a hot dose is when they take heroin and cocaine and sometimes battery acid, and they cook that up intentionally to kill a junkie so that you can rob them. So basically if you're a junkie, you want to rob another junkie, you cook them up a hot dose, give it to them and then take their shit.
So just to clarify, in that scene, you know, he says like she was left with like a little over $3,000 in
mint coins,
silver dollars or mint coins or whatever. Did she get the full $2 million from the safety deposit box and she only had $3,000 left?
No, because the $2 million was in Los Angeles.
That's where she went.
No, because she leaves the house.
She leaves the house, but she's got the keys that she stole out of the drawer. Me. And then she has the FBI, not the FBI, but the police officers. And she's like, go tell the bank teller to get me the bigger bag. And she's like trying to throw the money at the cops. But I was wondering, did she take the $2 million or was it just other money out of? So she took the money that he's like, don't ever marry someone you can't trust. And then she did exactly the thing.
Right. Yeah. So there was the money in Vegas, and then there was the jewelry in Vegas, and then there was the money in LA, and she got the LA money. She went to LA. That's where she dies in the motel. So she got that money, and she ended up with like $3,000 in coins.
But Jesus, that must have been some fucking party. Like $2 million, putting it up your nose or in your arm. Shit.
Unless they robbed her. Unless this hot dose.
Yeah.
Someone robbed her.
That they said when they found her, she had 3,500 mint coins left. She might have had more and they just robbed it.
How did she get arrested from the FBI and then get released and travel across state lines with $2 million in cash? I thought it was a lot harder to do that.
See, that's what I'm explaining. When she goes to the Vegas bank to get her jewelry, she gets the jewelry and a bunch of cash. They obviously, the FBI stops her. They probably take that. Then she goes to LA and that's when she liquidates the $2
million. Oh, see? I was struggling with the plot.
So with the mob out of power, the old casinos are purchased by big corporations and demolished. The corporations build new and gaudier attractions, which Sam laments are not the same as when the mafia was in control. Sam subsequently retires to San Diego and continues to live as a sports handicapper for the mob, in his own words, ending up right back where I started.
So are they trying to make some profound statement about Vegas? You know, that it's too corporate now and that back in the day it used to be better?
Yeah, I mean, but it's absolutely true. Like, I'm glad, like, Vegas did a thing in the 90s and early 2000s where they did that Disneylandification. They wanted to make it wholesome family fun. They put in the roller coasters, Excalibur, Circus. And I hate that part of Vegas. I hate New Vegas, too, where it's all about, like, nightclubs and shit like that. I prefer Old Vegas or Reno. I like that seedy, you know, gambling-based, alcohol, you know, booze-fueled nights sort of based thing. I'm nostalgic for the old days, and I feel what Scorsese is saying here.
Yeah, I went to Vegas this year for my birthday. There was a music festival going on, and I fucking hated it the entire time. I was in bed by 9 p.m., but if you go to places like Reno where it's like, I want to see old people smoking cigarettes inside with oxygen tanks, gambling like their social security checks. I want buffets. I want it bad. Like, I want to still see the tan leather tracksuits.
I mean, we could go to Gila River like this weekend if you want to go. It's right down the street.
Did you pack a vag pipe for the concert?
No, I've evolved now that I'm much older.
Yeah, now it's just shrooms and capsules. But, you know, but the thing is regardless of where the movie ends, I'm really glad that they picked up the pace at the end. The movie was dragging pretty hard until like the last, I don't know, 20 minutes. And they saved it a little bit. Scorsese saved it in the end by just packing in a bunch of action right at the end, a quick resolution. And it felt okay to me. It reminded me actually a lot of The Departed. And he does that in a lot of movies where when it hits you hard and fast at the end. So now is the time in the podcast where we do the Shat Meter score. If you haven't heard the Shat Meter score before, it ranges from zero wipes being a perfect movie, flawless. You don't need any wiping to get it off your bum. And a score of 5 means it's an absolute shit show disaster. Big D, we'll start with you. What is your score for Casino?
So I almost view it as two films. The first half, like I said, I loved. I thought it was nearly flawless. It was entertaining. The second half becomes less crime drama and more like domestic spat. If you cut out half of the Ginger leaving, Ginger comes back, she leaves. Nikki's fighting with Ace. You could have tightened it up. We didn't need some of the secondary plots. It would have been great. But they kind of lost me there towards the end. And it was just so long. It was so much. And it didn't need to be. It was bloated. I think if you had pared it down to maybe 2:30, it would have been a great, compelling story. Instead, it was a movie where, yeah, it was you liked the characters, you got engaged, but the pacing just made it hard to stay really in it. The end closes nicely. What can I say? I mean, I think I got to give it a three. A 2.5 is an average movie. I think the first half was a half wipe, one wipe. Second half was like a 4 for me. It was just, I didn't enjoy it. So unfortunately, I feel kind of bad saying it, but it's a three. It's an average movie. Would I watch it again? Hell no, just because of how long it was. But if it's ever on and I can catch the first half, yeah, I'd watch it. So I think three is fair for me.
I'm the opposite of you, Big D. I think that the first half was dreadfully boring to me, and it wasn't until the second half that I started to have any interest in the movie. But, you know, the sets, the costumes, the attention to detail, it's all incredible. The acting, I didn't feel like Sharon Stone or Robert De Niro were even acting. It just felt like so natural and believable. It was just so fucking long. I watched it in two sittings. I had to take several breaks. I had to Google stuff to keep up with the plot. I was lost. I mean, I don't care about gambling or mob, but I do feel like there's a lot of quality in the film. I mean, I do think Martin Scorsese is a great director and the acting was great in there. But I think it would have played out better as a series with, you know, more character development. I don't think I would recommend it as, you know, a movie that I love, but I think, you know, it's on all these lists of movies that you have to see before you die, or, you know, it is a good film. Would I watch it again? No, I would give it two wipes. Not the worst movie. I mean, it has things in it that are truly great, but it was just too long for me, too drawn out.
I mean, there's not much I can say that you guys haven't already said. Key scenes were absolutely brilliant. But this is nowhere near Goodfellas or The Godfather on the scale of great mafia movies. And that's really where I think you got to really have a benchmark there. Put something in its own genre and see how it stacks up. It was far, far too long, and it could have benefited from better editing. Everything was shot well. You just need to edit it more tightly. Be more discerning about what you're going to show. Again, Kerri, you're absolutely right. Sharon Stone and Robert De Niro were unbelievably good, but Big D, I agree with you. I cannot sit through this movie again. It's like, you know, one time I went for Valentine's Day, I went on a whale watching tour, and I'd never been whale watching or on the ocean in a boat before. And I realized as soon as I got out there about 15 minutes in that I was going to be seasick and it would not end. And now I don't like boats, you know, and I feel like this is going to make me hesitant to start any mafia movie, because I'm gonna be like, oh, Jesus Christ, what if it ends up like Casino? So for me, that being said, it's still an above average movie, but just slightly. So I'm going to go with two wipes. And that gives us an average score between my two, Kerri's two, and Big D's three. That's a 2.3 repeating average for Casino.
Oh, my God. I don't know what to think here. So this puts it tied at 28 with Rocky IV and Point Break.
Ooh,
it's right behind True Romance.
Here's the thing: it is not as good as True Romance. I will say that it is much better than Rocky IV. There's a chasm between those two movies, and that chasm is Roger Roper. But beside that, it's all a question of length. If this movie were cut down by an hour, I think it's a one wiper. It's just there's so much filler and garbage in there, and it's. You know, again, it goes back to that idea that it was a mishmash of different stories. You know, it got its inspiration from several different true mob stories.
Yeah, and I think back to what you were saying, comparing it like to The Departed. The Departed is compelling throughout. This, I feel like we're penalizing it for the time, but you have to. Because when you say it ran too long, that's telling you they had extra material that wasn't needed or relevant. For me, when I start looking at my watch, you've broken that magical connection with the screen that, you know, I'm involved in it, in this story. So I think it's fair, as ridiculous as it sounds, around True Romance, that area, it's where it should be. And anyone who has a problem with that, I dare you to sit down anytime after dark and try to watch this 3 hours and not fall asleep, or have to break it up into two sittings.
Okay, so that's your final score there. 2.3 repeating puts Casino tied with Point Break.
And 27.
I think we all feel awful.
We feel strange.
We feel strange about it.
We feel a little dirty, but it is what it is. You can't make it some... I'd sit down and watch Point Break right now.
Right, I had more fun with it.
Yeah, definitely.
The original Point Break. All right, now's the point in the podcast where we do shout-outs. Shout-outs are our way of saying thank you for listening to the podcast and visiting the website. Big D has done a lot of work on Shat the Movies and Shat on TV websites. They look great. So if you haven't seen them in a while, go to shatthemovies.com or shatontv.com. We made the shout outs a little bit easier to find, so you can find them on the side of the screen, or there's a slider as well. So look for them. If you put your name into a shout out box, we will read it on the podcast. This week's shout outs go out to General Shalafi, Molly Hun, Gene Ween, Boo Boo Fixer, Joshua Ryan, Troy, and Jeff Elmore. Thank you, everyone who listened and wrote in for a shout out. Again, if you want to hear your name read on the podcast, go to shatthemovies.com and put your name in the shout out box. Big D, what do we got coming up next week?
So next week was a highly contested category that was also recommended by a listener, Fantasy Heroes. So the contenders were Masters of the Universe from 87, Flash Gordon from 1980, the original Conan the Barbarian from 82, and Clash of the Titans from 81. So if you want to know which one it is, listen to the outro, and we're going to play the trailer. But also, if you go to the website, I just want to remind everybody, we have an Amazon affiliate link there. If you're going to do any shopping on Amazon, just go there before you do it, hit the link. And what Amazon does is they give us a small percentage of anything that you buy. We can't see what you're buying, but we just get a couple bucks here and there, and it helps. There is cost involved in, with the website and the feeds. Not to bitch and moan, boo-hoo-hoo, but it's a couple $1,000s a year. We do it for fun, so any help is appreciated.
Also, if you haven't gotten in on our contest, we're doing a contest with reviews. Again, we appreciate any reviews that you write for us on iTunes, and Big D has a very special gift for one lucky winner. Big D, you want to tell them about the contest?
So the contest is, if you go to iTunes and you leave us a review and you put in the review hashtag the name of the movie, at the end of the month, we will pick someone at random and review whatever movie they chose. And it's gone well so far. We've gotten probably 15 to 20 suggestions. And what has surprised me the most is that no one is attempting to throw us just a ball of shit. Everyone is recommending good movies like Goodfellas, Labyrinth, The Legend of Billie Jean, Goonies, things that you'd want to watch. Nobody yet has thrown us just a pile of shit like, I don't know, Prince of Tides, you know, that Barbra Streisand movie. Nobody's really tried to, and I'm surprised.
It might be, Big D, that we've watched every pile of shit possible, so they're just like running out of it. Like, well, they already did that one, they already did that one too. But no, there are far worse movies. I know Kerri has been pulling for Labyrinth, lobbying hard for it. So if you have any love for Kerri Gross, get Labyrinth mentioned.
I with my no tech knowledge, got a Twitter so I can start hashtagging Labyrinth. Please, please, guys, give me Labyrinth. I sat through this fucking 3-hour mob casino movie for Labyrinth.
Well, and again, if multiple people, you know, if 5 people write a review and put hashtag Labyrinth, it's like the NBA lottery. You're just increasing your chances of getting that first pick.
And Kerri, if people want to find you on Twitter, what is your Twitter handle?
How do I say it? It's at Kerri, my name, underscore gross, underscore, right?
That's right. And it's Kate.
Go to Shat the Movies and see who they're following and then look for me.
How do you put people's fucking lives in your hands? How you work in a fucking hospital where there's technology?
The medical field is analog. I don't need a fucking computer to do my job.
So there's no like diagnostics equipment where you have to at least work Windows like 95?
We do a lot of computer charting, but the fucking programs in the hospital are so outdated that, I mean, I'm using a Windows, I think that's what, not a, I'm using a PC on wheels that is broken half the time. I told you guys when you're setting me up, I'm like, the IT guys at the hospital know me by name. Like, I'm so terrible at it, they know me by name.
Yeah, I think the interview goes something like, can you use a touchpad? Yes. Are you comfortable with a strange man sticking his finger in your mouth while you're on the phone? And that's about all.
Yeah, if you guys want to follow me on Twitter, I talk about all the weird shit I see in the hospital while leaving my patients anonymous, so...
All right, that concludes this week's episode of Shat the Movies. Be sure to follow us on social media and share with a friend. We're on Twitter, Snapchat, and Instagram at Shat the Movies. Facebook, search for Shat the Movies Podcast. The website is shatthemovies.com. Email, if you'd like to suggest a category or some movies for us to watch, hosts at shatthemovies.com. Or if you just want to say hello, We're everywhere fine podcasts can be found, including iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, and YouTube. Be sure to subscribe. And if you stop by iTunes, be sure to leave a 5-star review. That helps the podcast grow. Also, you can check out our sister podcast, Shat on TV, where we review television series such as Taboo, American Gods, and Game of Thrones. You can find out all the information on our website, shatontv.com. We will have some Westworld news coming up very, very soon, so keep an eye out for that. We'll be putting that on all channels, and also the newsletter should be coming out shortly, so keep an eye out for that. Westworld should be coming back this April. All indicators point to that, so keep an eye out. On behalf of my co-hosts, Kerri Gross and Big D Dick Ebert, I'm Gene Lyons. Be sure to join us next week for...
The Labyrinth.
No. Then say, roll that trailer.
Roll that trailer, Big D.
Doom another day.
You have come to me, my son.
Who now is your father if it is not me?
Look at the strength of your body, the desire in your heart. I gave you this.
Now they will learn what is dear to them.